Hi, my name is Anthijuan Beeks Sr. and I'm the founder and CEO of Face to Face. Face to Face is an organization that brings resources and information to the communities on topics and issues that we face daily. Today we're here with Brother DJ and MADDADS, and we're going to be discussing some of those issues. Before I introduce Mr. Brother VJ, I just want you to know that you can reach me at www.facetoface.mn.com. You can also reach me at facetoface.mn1@gmail.com, or you can also reach me by phone, 612-702-9849. Without further ado, Brother VJ, thank you for allowing me to come in and train your staff.
Hey, it's a great honor to be here. Let me just share with you, I'm glad that you're here. Been knowing you for many, many years since you were shorty. Okay, so I'm excited about the work we're going to do, and I'm excited about people around the country that are going to be able to connect with you and learn from your expertise and your experience on how to solve problems in the community, because we need people like you, people that have been there and done that. So make sure you check them out. Watch what we're getting ready to do today. All right.
Hi, my name is Anthijuan Beeks Sr. and I'm the CEO and founder of Face to Face. And today I'm here with MADDADS, the chapter in Minnesota, Minneapolis, Minnesota. And I just wanted to give a little bit of a bio, if you will, on myself. Been born and raised here in the city of Minneapolis to Viola Mae Beeks Jr. Graduated from the Minneapolis public school system and went on to complete my law enforcement degree at Minneapolis Community College, where I became a police officer with the city of Minneapolis and was in that capacity for 12 years. Prior to that, I have a long, extensive history in security work, safety management, corrections, things of that nature, which has brought me to putting together a program that educates and informs individuals, families, youth, adults, communities on various topics that plague our communities on a daily basis. And today, again, I'm here with MADDADS, talking to them about some of these issues and concerns and providing them with solutions on what they can do as they're out there in the community, providing the services that they provide to the community. And before I get started, I'm going to do something just a little bit different today, because you guys have kind of been out there, you know, in the community, you know, dealing with youth, family, law enforcement, things of that nature. Can someone share with me some of the issues or concerns or things that you guys have been kind of coming across that you feel that would be, you know, vital and important today?
So many times we have law enforcement that don't understand that we're on their team. And so they look at us as another predator instead of looking at us as partners. How do we solve that?
That's a good question, Brother BJ. And the question was, is how do you work together with law enforcement in order for them to see you as a friend instead of a foe? Was that correct?
Absolutely.
All right. So my question to you is knowing your resources. There's all different type of resources out there when it kind of comes to law enforcement. You know, in the city of Minneapolis, you know, you have the city of Minneapolis Police Department. You have Hennepin County Sheriff, who is out there a lot. And then you also have Metro Transit, who is out there a lot. And my thing is that I would strongly encourage that you get with those commanders of the various sectors that you're working. Because from my understanding, you guys kind of work downtown a lot. So I would get with the downtown commander. You guys, Hennepin County Sheriff is down there a lot, along with you guys do a lot of stuff with the Metro Transit bus system. So I would also get with that commander and have some type of quarterly meeting, you know, with these individuals. So then therefore you can build these relationships and see exactly what their strategy is, you know, share with them what your strategy is, and then see if you guys can come together you know, to see if you guys' strategies are on the same page, because sometimes what law enforcement sees is not the same thing that you see, you know, because you guys are just kind of coming at a particular problem from two different directions, if that makes sense. They're looking at it more from a criminal type of aspect, and you're looking at it more from a community point, you know. However, at the end of the day, you both are trying to find out a solution for this particular problem, whatever that issue may be. So that is what I would strongly suggest, is that you keep in contact and communication, you know, with these individuals. Have them, invite them into, you know, your place of business. Kind of show them what it is that you're doing. Now, I know that you guys have been working with, you know, with law enforcement for a long time, and a lot of them know you. However, as you know, there's been a lot of retirements, a lot of new hires, you know, within all of these agencies. So the new people that don't know you, you know, invite them in. Let them know, you know, what MADDADS is doing and what MADDADS is about. Is there any other thing that, yes, sir?
There's no place for the young kids to go that's positive for them to go.
So the question was, your statement was that there is no positive place for them to go right now.
Correct.
And that is doing what to the youth, or for the youth?
It's putting them in bad situations, so they flood the downtown area because it's something to do, that they know police presence is there. So even though they act out, it's something for them to do. But we don't have those in the neighborhoods anymore. We don't have rec centers that stay open at 10 o'clock anymore that provides activities for the youth. So they're just out in the streets with nothing to do. And that, you know, idle mind is the devil's workshop.
So you're saying that because of there being no rec centers or just other positive resources for them to kind of get involved with that are open later in the evenings and things of that nature, that it's allowing them to flood the downtown Minneapolis area and cause all different type of destruction or various issues and concerns downtown Minneapolis.
Correct.
Is that what I'm getting at?
Correct.
Okay. I will say this here. MADDADS is a very influential organization, you know, across the country. I believe that, you know, MADDADS can get a lot of things done. And you guys have gotten a lot of things done. And I thank you for your service. With that being said, this is what I would suggest. Again, you know, building those relationships with those entities that needs to be, you know, in on what it is that you would like to see. You know, draw up a plan of what you guys would like to see happen, you know, with this youth. Here's an idea. How about MADDADS, you know, get with the appropriate organization, because there's a ton of property within the city of Minneapolis where there's vacant buildings, you know, and people are trying to rent out buildings or trying to sell property, you know, for, you know, things just like what you're talking about for the youth, and having it open late and having your staff supervise it and stuff like that there. See if there's some of these buildings out here that you guys might be able to get your hands on, and then therefore it will be, you know, something that you guys know that is open and that is out there for the youth. Yes, brother.
You know, racism is real. It's still alive in police departments all across the country.
Absolutely.
With the latest things that are going on with Ferguson and St. Louis and all the different areas, how do we, and from your experience as a law enforcement officer, what should we, the public, do, and how do we try to resolve this, the racism in the police departments?
Well, first of all, I just have to correct you. I'm no longer a law enforcement officer. I'm a former law enforcement officer, even though that my license is still good for about another 3 years.
Okay.
However, your question was, is how do you, well, let me back up. You were saying that racism is still a big issue within law enforcement. And how do you kind of communicate, you know, with law enforcement, you know, and try to get over the hump of racism? Is that what I'm,
Absolutely.
Hearing? Okay. All right. This is the thing. It's knowing, you know, some of your resources. And I will kind of keep coming back that, again, because there's a lot of different resources out there. And so I do know that agencies, and not just Minneapolis, but there's a lot of agencies out there that are truly doing what they can to hire a lot more minorities within the field of law enforcement. It's just, unfortunately, there's not as many minorities in law enforcement as we would like to see here in the state of Minnesota. So I encourage, you know, all of you to inform, you know, friends and family, you know, that if you have some young ones in your community, in your family, in your neighborhoods, that are interested in law enforcement, you know, have them reach out to, you know, a school and look into what they can do, you know, to become a correctional officer or a peace officer or wherever it is that they would like to go up under the umbrella of law enforcement. But to try to further answer your question, a lot of it is based on having true dialogue. And when you're having true dialogue, there's a lot of things that need to be said, should be said, and will be said, but individuals cannot get caught up in personal opinions, you know, personal biases. You have to be open-minded enough to know that this particular issue or concern, and in this case it's racism, it's bigger than just you as an individual. This is something that is much broader, and if you're truly here to help your community, your city, then you will be able to sit back with an open mind and listen to exactly what these problems and concerns are, and try to do what can be done in order to find real solutions for that problem. But the number one thing, and hopefully I've answered your question, is communication, communication, communication. And just being dedicated the way that MADDADS has been out there in the community.
Communication. Police talk one way, citizens talk another way. We're not always taught that way to communicate. Can you give us some tips on the best way to communicate with officers? Example, hey, there's some dudes ran off down there. I know they did something. Okay, an officer says, well, yeah, when you find out what they did, let us know. So what's the best way to communicate with officers to get action, to take action?
Okay. Again, let's say that I'm a police officer, okay, and you have some information that you want to give me about something that you just saw, okay? Tell me what you want me to know.
Hey, man, some dudes running down there, man. I think they snatched that lady's purse.
Okay, so you just told me that some dudes ran a certain direction, which you didn't say which direction, and you think they just snatched the lady's purse. As an officer, what am I supposed to do with that?
Start running down that way.
I got a scenario.
Hold on, I'm gonna get to you for just one second, because I want to answer his thing. Okay. So then, therefore, you guys will understand that when you go to a police officer, you need to go to him or her with information that's accurate and it's significant, so then therefore they have something to go off of. Let's try this. You're the police officer, and now I want to give you information, okay? And now I'm all in my MADDADS attire. I have my shirt on. It says MADDADS. I have my hat on. It says MADDADS. I have my radio and stuff like that there, and I may be with, two or three other individuals that also says MADDADS, okay? So we're clearly identified, you know, ourselves as being, you know, part of MADDADS, right? That's the number one thing. It's all about appearance and approach. Just like a law enforcement officer, when they come to a certain situation, they have on what? A uniform.
Yeah.
A uniform that pretty much identifies themselves as, hey, I work for the city of whatever, and, you know, I'm here to help you with this particular situation, you know, and we have badges and patches and stuff like that there, and I may even be accompanied by a couple of other officers. You may even see my patrol vehicle, which is all giving you the understanding, you know, that I'm here to help. So now, again, you're the police, and I'm MADDADS. Officer, my name is Mr. Beeks. I was just down there on 5th and Hennepin, and I saw a black male about 6 feet tall, you know, wearing tan Timberland boots, blue jeans, with a black shirt, you know, and a white hat, run westbound on 5th, and he snatched an elderly lady's purse. I believe that purse is black. She's still down there. You know, she needs help. We left one of our staff people down there with her, you know, to make sure that she's okay. Can you please call someone, you know, to go down there and get the ball rolling? You see how I introduced myself? Wow. How I gave you pertinent information, something that you can go off of. So now you as an officer is going to get on your radio and say, I'm out at 6th and Hennepin, you know, and I'm with, you know, VJ from MADDADS, and he's providing me this information. Can we get squads to check a certain direction for this black male fitting this description? You see what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So that was a huge difference from the first time, you know, you gave me that scenario, correct?
That's correct.
Okay. So again, it's all about making sure that you give accurate and pertinent information, so then therefore they have something to go off of.
And it was a white male.
It was a white male?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Go ahead, sir. You had something that you...
No, you pretty much explained it, what you want. Because I was going to say, what if I came up to you and said, you know, there's so-and-so right here at the bus stop smoking weed. You know what I mean? As a police officer, can they do something right there? Because a lot of times when we do tell police officers, say, hey, man, I know this guy right here is selling weed. You know what I mean? They're like, well, okay. You know what I mean? They just keep on moving what they're doing. You know what I mean? Like, they don't care. So, like, I don't know. That's just...
Well, there's a couple things. And again, it kind of goes back to knowing your resources. Now, if you're seeing something that's happening on a bus line in downtown, and we're just going to, you know, pick on Minneapolis because that's the city that we're in currently right now. So if you see something on the bus line, and you believe something is going on, with that same scenario, who you gonna call?
If it's on a bus line, ain't it Metro?
Absolutely.
Absolutely.
Wow. So, if you go up to an officer, you know, you pretty much need to make sure that it's a, you know, Metro, you know, a transit peace officer. I'm not saying that another city agency such as Minneapolis or Hennepin County Sheriff or whatever the case may be could not take action, you know, but the way that law enforcement works is, you know, we have kind of specific duties and kind of certain jurisdictions and things of that nature. And so, therefore, if that's happening on transit property, then we're going to typically, or I should say Minneapolis is going to typically allow Metro Transit, you know, to take care of that issue, depending on that particular issue. Now, obviously, if it's, you know, something much bigger or something a little bit more serious and stuff like that there, then I'm certain that, you know, any particular agency is going to kind of step in and deal with the problem. And then Metro Transit would then kind of, you know, take it over and do all of the necessary paperwork, etc.
Okay, so we got a problem on 5th and Hennepin. Everybody knows that, right? Mm-hmm. And now, like, suppose if a fight breaks out, there's a bus stop right here, there's a train right here, and there's a police officer down here at the theater place, and there's Metro Transit over here. So who do I go to if a fight breaks out?
Now, you're saying that it's on
No, 5th and Hennepin. There's a bus stop, like, right there. There's a train. The train's right here. Mm-hmm. And suppose I see a Metro Transit police officer right there standing by the train, and I see an actual police officer down by the theater. Who would I go to that'll actually help the situation?
If I kind of heard you a little bit, you were saying that there's an officer that's kind of inside of the theater.
Yeah, there's an officer inside the theater.
Okay. Now, if I'm hearing you correctly, then that officer more than likely is going to be an off-duty officer that's working for that theater.
Okay.
So he or she is not going to be the person that you want to run to, because they're getting paid for that theater. So if they leave that theater and go and help you with this fight or whatever the case may be, and now something happens in that theater, you know, then that's going to create a whole nother, situation. Okay. So whoever's working at theater, then, you know, that's where they're working at for that particular night for whatever hours that they're hired to work there.
Okay.
I would definitely go to that transit officer, okay? If for some odd reason, you know, you're not getting the type of response that you feel that you need to receive from that particular officer, you know, you're always, you know, more than welcome to call 911, okay? And stay on the line, you know, with the dispatcher, you know, provide updates, you know, I'll get you in just one second, brother. And, you know, and these are the things that happen. And in a kind of a correct world, you know, you're supposed to get an officer and say, yes, let's go, let's find out what's going on, you know, but yes, we know that we run into certain officers that are unwilling, if you will, to provide adequate service. We get that. We know it. You know, we don't necessarily understand why. At times, there may be various situations that might be going on. I don't know. But if you're not getting the type of response that you feel you need to receive, then call 911, you know, and hopefully that, and as you guys know, downtown can be a very busy place.
Yeah.
You know, it can be a very busy place, all right? So calls come in and they prioritize their calls, all right? So a fight, you know, between, you know, several individuals are not going to be as high as if there is some type of domestic with a weapon somewhere, or there might have just been some other type of situation, you know, with a weapon, or, you know, an officer need help call or something like that there, then it just slowly but surely bumps down, you know, that level in prioritizing that call. So it may take a while.
Is it okay to ask officers before anything happens to kind of know your perimeter, to say, excuse me, officer, are you off duty? Because if something happens, are we not going to be able to call you? Or can you at least radio something in for us? Is it okay to ask officers, are they off duty?
Absolutely. You know, I mean, and they might answer you. Everybody say, yeah, I'm working for the theater right here. You know, one of the things that, and I don't know if you guys do or not, you know, is when you guys are working downtown, let's just say on a particular Friday night, you know, busy hours between, you know, 10 and 2 or whatever it is that you guys are down there, I would strongly suggest that you go to the downtown precinct and speak with, you know, a supervisor, you know, that's down there, and let them know that, hey, we have a team of 5 out here tonight. And, you know, we're going to be down here from 10 p.m. to 2 a.m. And we're pretty much going to be kind of in the area from, you know, the library, you know, up to, you know, 8th Street. Wow. You know, pretty much from, you know, 1st Avenue over to Nicollet Mall or however it is that you guys is going to do this. So then, therefore, and ask him to send out a message to their officers, you know, to let them know that, hey, you know, we have MADDADS down here, and this is all about communication, building that relationship, you know, kind of letting them know the mindset that you guys are kind of on. You know, you guys can then kind of gauge, you know, the type of response, you know, that you're getting from that supervisor. You know, there's a lot of different things that kind of go on, you know, as you guys are having this dialogue. You know, I don't know, by a show of a hand, you know, kind of who is the supervisor in your group, you know, that would be downtown. Okay, so then therefore you two individuals, you know, would be, you know, doing the one that would be kind of connecting with that supervisor, you know, and you would supervise your team and you provide the necessary information, so on and so forth, so then that he or she can supervise their team. You see what I'm getting at here?
No.
You know, and even you guys have had turnover. You know, so how do we get to know one another? You know, you invite them in to your home, which is your workplace here, like you have with me today, and then therefore we have, you know, some donuts with them. I mean, cops love donuts, right? I knew y'all was gonna go there. But you know, but these are the type of things that are going to, you know, build these relationships, build these understanding, give individuals a better understanding and perspective on exactly what MADDADS do. Because, you know, and just keeping it real, I'm sure that, you know, not everyone out there, you know, either knows or appreciates what it is that you guys do. Okay? And the only way that you guys are going to be able to get that done, you know, or to bridge that gap, if you will, is by inviting them in. Correct?
But I've personally witnessed, like, 3 or 4 cops in one area. I've seen 3 huge fights break out, and they literally, I watched the fights go on for like 5 to 10 minutes before they do something.
I still have a lot of friends on the department. And there's a lot of things that you guys as MADDADS don't know. There's a lot of things that community members don't know. There's a lot of things that law enforcement are not going to share with you. That's just kind of how it is. So, how do we rectify that problem? And you're saying that you're seeing situations breaking out and you have law enforcement officers that are pretty much right there and they're not responding until it kind of comes or turns into a bigger situation instead of them kind of taking care of it at a lower level within the city of Minneapolis. And we're not just talking about downtown right now. We're talking about a lot of, you talked about earlier how you didn't want to get into some of the political stuff. But see, this is the thing, is that in order for one to understand exactly what's going on and why folks do what they do and how they do what they do, et cetera, et cetera, you have to kind of, you know, go back to square one, you know, and again, have that real true dialogue with them, you know. Sit in various community meetings, you know, get to know, you know, some of these community engagement officers, you know, things like that there. Do ride-alongs, you know, with your city. There's all different type of things you can do in order to gain further knowledge and insight on why, you know, people do what they do. Just like I, you know, has stated earlier, invite them here to your place and therefore they can see what you do. Go out and do a ride along with them. You know, go out and meet, you know, an officer. You know, so then therefore you can have, you know, that one-on-one dialogue. You know, build a relationship. You never know, you might meet a friend, you know, that's going to give it to you real the way that, you know, you need to hear it. So, back to what I was saying, there's been a lot of situations that have been occurring within the city. Roads being blocked off, African American men, you know, being killed by law enforcement, and it's not just here in the city, but it's throughout the country. But again, it has a very profound effect, you know, on us right here as well. You've had highways, you know, being blocked. You've had, you know, certain organizations, you know, creating various fuss about certain things that are going on. And that's all fine because it all kind of has a place, you know, for that particular reason at that particular time. But I will say this here. There's been a lot of things that have been taken off the table, you know, when it kind of comes to law enforcement, you know, being able to be proactive, okay? One of the things that has been taken off the table, I'm sure that you guys might have heard, they used to have a loitering ordinance.
Yeah.
You know, now that's no longer, you know, on their books. They can really no longer, you know, approach whom they feel is a suspicious person standing in a particular area at a particular time, late at night, preferably, next to some type of closed business, you know, and there's, you know, not a bus stop there. It's, things are not adding up. So as a peace officer, I'm asking myself, why is this guy standing here? You know, however, nowadays an officer has to be, you know, extremely cautious and aware. So then therefore, when they call themselves doing their job, that they don't get jammed up. Because they too, just like all of us, we have a family to feed. We have a job to do. We want to do it safely and we want to go home with as less issues and concerns as possible. Can I get an amen on that?
Amen.
Okay. Amen. Because I know I want to go home at the end of the night, and I'm sure all of you do as well. So these are just some of the minor things that we all are aware of. But I guarantee you, there's a lot more things out there that run much deeper than just this minor loiter, you know, policy, city ordinance that they had, that is really kind of tying law enforcement's hands on what they can do, when they can do, why they can do, if they cannot do, you know, etc., etc., etc. So we can sit here, and I'll get right to you, brother. We can sit here all day and talk about what they're doing, what they're not doing, how they can do it better, you know, et cetera, et cetera. Okay? But the bottom line is this here. Until we fully know kind of who they are, what they do, how they do, et cetera, et cetera, you're not going to know. Vice versa. If you don't invite them into your place and allow them to see what you do and how you do and why you do, they're not really going to know. So maybe, you know, with your connections, Mr. VJ, you know, you can go over here to the 5th precinct or go over here to the 3rd precinct, you know, and put on, you know, a 30-minute information session, you know, to, you know, their officers. Go and ask, can you be invited to their roll calls? and give a 5-minute, 10-minute little information session on what you do, why you do, etc., etc. You know, these are the type of things that's going to build bridges, build relationships, you know, builds trust. It's gonna do a lot of things. And it's just the simple small things that we can do, and they as well, you know. And when I say we, I'm talking about Mad Dads, I'm talking about the police department, I'm talking about the community, you know, I'm talking about face to face, you know, I'm talking about all of us. It's a lot of little things that we can do to improve public relations, you know, when it kind of comes to the public and police. There's all different type of things you can do. You know, use your imagination, you know. And I would be absolutely shocked if Brother VJ went anywhere and was on something extremely positive and productive and came to them with an idea that was not going to cost a whole lot of money. It was not going to cost, you know, any type of real safety issue or concerns or, you know, anything like that there. And he says, this is what I want to do. You know, bring two or three of my guys in here with me to a roll call once a month, whether it's day watch, mid watch, dog watch. You know, can we set up some type of event, like you said, like a bowling event, or it'd be Mad Dads against the police, you know, or whatever the case may be. I guarantee you they're not going to say no.
Officers always talk southbound, westbound, eastbound, and, you know, really, humans don't talk like that. You know, they don't talk about west or south, you know. Mm-hmm. And so how do you know which is westbound?
One of the things that that you will kind of know, or if you don't know, you will know after today, streets. If you have, like, you know, Lake Street, you know, all of the streets pretty much is going to run east and west. Okay? So all of your streets is going to run east and west. Okay? All of your avenues, if you will, is going to run north and south. Okay? So sometimes you just kind of have to know a little bit of kind of where you're at in order for you to, you know, kind of be able to know. So let's just say, for example, that, you know, we're here at 4th Avenue and Lake Street, okay? So now we know that Lake Street runs what?
East and west.
East and west. And 4th Avenue runs?
North and south.
North and south. Okay, so now we're going to go ahead and we're going to take that same scenario that we talked about earlier, and you're going to come up to me and you're going to say what?
I just seen a guy with blue jeans on and a white t-shirt. He went west on Lake Street, right between 4th Avenue. He went west on Lake Street. He ran all the way down West Lake Street. And he had a black purse. And the elderly woman, she's going to need some help. She's on 4th Avenue, right on the 4th, going east.
All right, let me stop you, sir.
She's going east. Help! Don't stop me. Help!
No, I'm going to stop you. Because this is good, though. This is really good. Because the thing is when we are excited about something, right, or we feel that we want to help and we want to get this information out, you know, what do? You mix up directions. You know, you're talking real excited. You're giving us a lot of information in a very short period of time. And before you came up to me, you know, I was just kind of just having to be an officer standing on this corner, you know, might have been doing a foot beat and just got through checking this theater, you know, or something like that there. So now, mentally, I have to catch up to what it is that you're saying. So don't be offended
you know, if I stop you at some point and just say, whoa, whoa, wait a minute, slow down for a second, you know, and I might have to get out my notebook and a pen, and you're going to be looking at me like, man, what's taking you all day?
Yeah, we ain't got time
for all of this. But see, this is the thing that's going to, even though that it's taking me some time to write this down, okay, when I call it in, I want to be as accurate as I possibly can, you know, with the race, the approximate age, the build, the clothing color, you know, if it was a design on the front, whatever it is, I need to be as accurate. One of the things, and I'm sure that you guys probably heard this or have seen this, you know, how many times have you guys kind of played the old game slug bug? You know, but you play red. Anytime you've seen a red slug bug, you're going to get socked in the arm, right? Yeah. And then all of a sudden, you're seeing red slug bugs all over the place. You know, so if you ain't quick enough, your arm begins to hurt. So how many times have you guys seen, you know, individuals in jeans and a white tee?
In a hoodie.
A whole bunch of times. So I'm going to need a little bit more than some jeans and a white tee. So then therefore, I might have to ask you these questions in order for me to take a minute or two, in order for me to be able to inform, you know, dispatch. So then therefore, as squads are responding to that area, you know, they know exactly a little bit more of what they're looking for. These are the type of things that builds that understanding, builds that trust, because now you kind of know why they have to kind of take out that pen and paper. It's going to be very few officers that's going to be able to get on that radio right away and trying to listen to you, and then also trying to speak into this microphone. Because the thing is I'm trying to speak, you're trying to tell me what's going on, dispatch is now hearing the both of us. So they don't know, you know, which information that they're trying to, you know, disseminate and stuff like that there. You know, so again, it's just slow down, you know, give it to them, you know, in kind of a chronological order. Officer, my name is VJ. With MADDADS, I just saw a white male run eastbound on Lake Street from 4th Avenue. He just snatched an elderly lady's purse. Right down around the corner, she's waiting at the bus stop. You know, he had on, you know, Timberland boots, blue jeans, you know, a black shirt. He had on a hat, you know, I believe the lady said her purse was, you know, was light brown. You know, it was a leather light brown purse. You know, stuff like that there. And this is the type of information. So then all of a sudden, if we, you know, well, obviously, you know, you see a dude running down the street with any type of purse, you know, he's going to be suspicious. But the thing is, you know, we see this person, you know, trotting down, maybe, you know, he's in turn, you know, southbound, you know, on 3rd Avenue, you know. But now all of it, because now he's gotten off the main street. He's gotten off the beaten path, right? You know, but now all of a sudden a squad car coming down 3rd sees this individual with this excellent description that you have provided, he's caught. You know what I'm saying? Now, you know, we can begin to celebrate. You know, but if I'm getting on the air, you know, two or three different times, you know, adding this and adding that and adding this, and in some cases you have to, but you want to minimize that. Mm-hmm. Because as an officer, and this is another thing that you guys don't know, but as an officer, you know, I have peers just like you guys have peers. And if you as a supervisor is seeing one of your peers, you know, jumping on y'all's radio or doing certain things that is not correct, if you will, or according to you guys' procedures and policies, you know, several of you guys are going to be looking at, well, what's wrong with this dude? Mm-hmm. You know, he can't seem to get nothing right on the radio or whatever the case, and don't know where he at, you know, et cetera, et cetera. And that kind of what goes on in law enforcement as well, And you know, he or she doesn't want to be pulled into, you know, the supervisor's office, because believe you me, you know, if you're not doing things appropriately, mm-hmm. you're gonna have to answer to somebody. So, Mr. Supervisor, one of your tasks is then, and one of the things I'm gonna put out to you then is, as you're out and about, you know, with your team, you know, stop on a corner. And as you guys is, you know, just chit-chatting, maybe having a little drink of soda or maybe some chips because you're kind of taking a little break, you know, hey, VJ, where are we at? You know, I'm sure you might have to look up and be like, oh, we're at 4th and Lake Street. Okay, which direction is that? You know, challenge your people. You know, so then therefore, they'll know. And believe you me, after a while, you guys will start to think about, yeah, this is where I'm at. This is this direction. That's that direction. Because as peace officers, I can't even begin to imagine, you know, recall how many times I was working overnight, black as you want to be outside, and then all of a sudden, you know, you're with your field training officer in the middle of a block, and he say, stop. You know, and all of a sudden, you know, you slam on the brakes because you're thinking, hey, did I miss something? What did he see that I didn't see? And then so he just asks you, where you at? Mm. And you're like, oh, man. And, you know, and back in the day, you know, we didn't have these fancy computers that have all of the, you know, directions of where you're at and GPS and all that other type of stuff. Mm-hmm. And they'll tell you, don't look at that computer. You know, and then you're just like, man, if you didn't know, you didn't know. Mm-hmm. You know, but the thing is say you don't know and then learn. Opposed to saying, oh, well, I believe I'm at 4th Avenue. I don't know. I believe I'm at 4th Street and Lake Street. Mm-hmm. What? Where in the city does that intersect?
Yeah, right.
So now, you know, if you find yourself in trouble and you're like, yeah, squad 420, I'm at 4th Street and Lake Street. You know, your team or a lot of your team is going to know that, man, where is that at? You don't even know where you at. Now you're sending individuals in directions or something like that there that they don't even know. Now the person who snatched the purse earlier is going to be gone. You know, the officer that needs that help, it's going to take them a little bit more time to know. Now, in some cases, you know, some of us veteran officers is going to know, oh, man, he meant 4th Avenue and Lake Street. Let's go. You know, but you just want to make sure that you know exactly where you're at, what you're doing, descriptions, directions, things of that nature, if that makes sense to you. We learned a few things here today. One of the things I believe that we learned is about, you know, streets and avenues and what directions that they go, and that you guys are going to start paying a lot more closer attention, you know what I'm saying? So then therefore, when you guys are giving out information, you know, you guys will be able to provide that accordingly. All right. We kind of came up with various ideas and possibilities of what MADDADS can do to work better, you know, with law enforcement, having these various quarterly meetings, if you will, again, inviting them into your home, you know, letting them see, you know, going to them, whether it's via roll calls, doing ride-alongs, you know, stuff like that there that may help. Bowling events, just whatever other events. And I know that MADDADS is pretty busy, you know, in the spring and summer months. So you guys might want to start thinking about some of those things now as it's going into the fall and winter when it's not as busy, you know, for you guys or maybe even for them. I don't know. So again, it's we talked about, you know, communication and some of the things that we can do to build public relations with law enforcement. Some of the things that we kind of touched on that I really kind of wanted to get into, and maybe we might be able to do this again with some of the biases, you know, that individuals have. And I just want to kind of touch on that just a little bit here real quick. We have a lot of our own biases. There's always something that, you know, we feel a certain way about, whether that's right, wrong, or indifferent. And law enforcement officers do as well. And you kind of touched on a little bit earlier in regards to racism. And there might be, I'm sure that there are, you know, some officers that, you know, feel that a lot of African American individuals, you know, males out here in the community are, you know, lack of better words, thug. You know, they have on, you know, the Timberland boots, saggy jeans, and whatever else that they have put in their mind that represents a thug or a person that's up to no good or whatever the case may be. We kind of touched on a little bit earlier, I can't remember exactly who kind of posed the question as far as getting kind of the officers to do their job. We just want them to kind of do their job. And some of those things is that, you know, what we didn't know before is they might be working a part-time job somewhere. You know, I've heard it even when I was an officer. Oh man, you know, you're an Uncle Tom. You know, just other things like that there, you know, that may pop up that just kind of perpetuates, you know, this division. Kind of perpetuates these stereotypes, kind of perpetuates a lot of negativity, if you will. And I promise you, and I can almost guarantee you, that if there are certain things, and these, like I said, just small things, if there are certain small things that were done for people as far as the community, police, etc., to truly, truly be transparent. It's a word you'll hear a lot in law enforcement. But if individuals would truly be transparent, we would see just how much we are more alike than we are different. Again, I thank you for allowing me to come in and be part of this here. Again, my name is Anthijuan Beeks Sr. I am the CEO and founder of Face to Face, and you can definitely contact me at www.facetofacemn.com. You can also contact me facetofacemn1@gmail.com, and my phone number is 612-702-9849. I wish all of you nothing but the best. God bless, and thank you.
My man, Dad, and I'm also the chair for Central Area Neighborhood Development Organization. So this is this area right here. So it's been very beneficial just for me to get the understanding of what officers or former officers are thinking in their mind, the mindset that they have.
I just really enjoyed that. I've been taking notes.
Okay.
It's been fantastic having you here again. I am Mother Deborah, the president of the Moms Division. And thank you. We hope that you do come and see us again and talk
absolutely,
to us again.
Absolutely. I got to give you a hug on that. Absolutely.
You showed me a lot of things about how to communicate with the police officer, especially if I see a crime that's going down. The where I'm at as far as streets east and west and avenues north and south, I had no clue about that. That just blew me right there. So I appreciate that, you know, as well. And, you know, some of the ideas that you told me about, you know, going, seeing if I can go to the roll calls and talking with the police, letting the police officers know that we're down there. Because a lot of times when we are downtown, we don't even really let them know. We see them on the beat, we say hi, and that's it. You know what I mean? We don't stop and have a lot of conversations, which we do need to have that conversation. Because we are in the trenches, breaking up fights and stuff like that. Because we all on the same side. We all want to see peace in the community. So I appreciate that. And Appreciate you.
Thank you. Absolutely.
All right, for sure.
If you don't, I'm going to be looking for you.
Oh, yeah.